All right, everyone, I want to thank you so much for joining us today on our show called The Remnant. This show is sort of devoted to a side of myself and my wife's life that we're proud of, but it's not an easy thing to sort of communicate because it happens through revelation and transference through God. And that is talking about the power of God, talking about the deeply spiritual part of Christianity. Those things are really hard to communicate, and if you don't know how hard it is, just try sometimes to explain to somebody about those intimate and deep details of spiritual Christianity. It's not easy to explain to someone because you're asking them to accept everything that you're saying based upon faith.
Yeah.
And most of the times, if people don't know you, you know, they're just not going to potentially believe you, that there is a real spiritual side of Christianity that is not just about good works or humanism or, you know, stuff like that, or even good theology. Theology, you can get lost in that. The Pharisees did, and the Sadducees did. And they lost an ability to remember that God was meant to be experienced. And that's been a part of my life and my wife's life in a way that has impacted us deeply. Our experiences with God, you know, and I'm not putting down someone who hasn't had them, but I want to encourage you to be a little bit more open. Maybe when God takes time to visit you in a special way and to give you opportunity to relax and wait on Him and see if something will happen that's deeply, well, spiritual, be it in a church or just at home alone, you know, give it some time and have some patience and wait. And everything good doesn't happen immediately. We're in a fast food type of generation, and we just believe that if there's not results immediately, well, move on. And there is times to move on, no two ways about that. Not every pursuit is good, and just because you wait doesn't mean everything bad is going to become good. But sometimes when it is something good and it takes a little bit of time, don't despair. When other people tell you, yeah, it's true, wait, just wait. We'll do that, you know?
And there is an evidence. It's joy. It's finding the presence, like we were talking about here, finding joy and deep peace that nothing else can give you. You know, that is the evidence of a spiritual experience with God.
And Lem and I were just talking today too about, wow, being led by peace. Oh, my dear, it is so very important. And when that peace is gone, oh, wow, it's just such a definite that God isn't in it. You know, sometimes the challenges are big enough that it overwhelms our feelings. But when we settle down a bit, we know, okay, yeah, we still have a peace about this. And there's challenges in everything. So, I mean, just because you're challenged doesn't mean God's not in it. Just the opposite. God gives you challenges. He makes you have faith in Him, you know, and proves Himself. So, yeah, we just encourage you to allow Christianity to be what it is, what it was at its best day, that is deeply spiritual, able to be experienced and real, tangible. God is real. And that's part of why we're doing this book here today, The Practice of the Presence of God. Now, to be totally honest with you, first of all, I think this book must come in about 20 different versions, okay? And I've got the old English unabridged version, and Lem's got like the new version. And I was like struggling through mine, and I said, does yours say thus unto, you know, unto thine? And Lem said, no. And I said, well, I don't understand. Is it the same book? But yeah, but she just had the like abridged brand new version of it. I don't know what version you may have ended up with, but I think it's all the same book. I hope it's, and I mean, it's a short book, and I don't know how many books can have the same title. So
It's the same book.
it's the same book.
I think it's unabridged versions.
And I mean, really, when I think of deeply spiritual, how I've been affected by an understanding of the gospel, that's how I have been deeply changed recently. And you know, that's the revelation I'm in right now, is just the truth and awesomeness of the gospel, not just the simple message, but just the all-consuming message. Like Jesus said, a man found a treasure in a field and went and sold all he had so he could buy the field. Well, that's a good deal. Because if nobody else recognizes the treasure in the field, well, you got yourself a deal when you sold all you had and bought the field. Because you got a whole lot more than you ever, you know, bought the field for. Because then you own the treasure that was in the field. And that's how I feel. I feel like I'm a guy, and I think I can even speak for Lem. I think we're people who have found a treasure in a field. All you got to do is give up what? Your stinky life in order to have it? What do you have anyway?
That's
Be
right.
real, even if it's great, what do you got? I got a good idea, no matter how good it is, it's stinky. And you may as well just do what Jesus says, which is basically give up your life so that you can have one. And I don't mean that in the sense of dying physically, but dying to your own will and your own desires, taking up your crosses. It's not as how can you put it, hard as they want to make it out to be.
Yeah.
It's not like heroes only do what are great people
yeah.
that you admire or admired as kids.
Yeah.
No, there's yeah. anyone can do it.
Mm-hmm.
You do it in your small way or in your whatever, yeah. in your big way.
Yeah.
But it's for everyone to do. It doesn't omit yeah. anyone.
Yeah.
So, yeah, anyway, that's kind of what's impressing upon me is so, I mean, reading this book was kind of like, okay, this is different. Now, this was written by a guy in the 1600s. They didn't have near the amount of teaching that we have today.
Mm.
And today is, what do they call it? The information age. It's also the misinformation age and the too much information age. It's information. If yeah. anybody ever said knowledge will increase, boy, they were right. That's what Daniel said years ago in the book of Daniel.
Yeah.
It has increased.
Yeah.
But, you know, wisdom is the key thing, not yeah. knowledge.
Yeah.
And anyway, this man had some wisdom. What he didn't have was probably a real grasp on scripture like our era does today. We
yeah.
really have a lot of people that crunch through scriptures
mm-hmm.
and really give us a security fence for our belief
yeah.
system. And just remember, your security fence is not, that's not the goal of scripture.
Yeah.
That was only meant to define the parameters.
Yeah, that's right.
What I mean to say, it wasn't meant to limit experience.
Yeah.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
So the safety parameters are there so you don't fall off the trampoline. I remember we had this trampoline, this blue, humongous blue trampoline, and boy, the kids would go crazy on it. They loved it, and we had it for a few years, and I can't imagine what would have happened if it didn't have those safety bars and that safety mesh. I mean, I don't know how many broken bones there would have been,
yeah.
you know, between our kids and the neighbor's kids, you know, somebody would have ended up dead
yeah.
if it hadn't been for all that safety that was there. But the safety made it so that you could enjoy an experience.
Yeah.
And that's what the Word of God does. It surrounds us with safe theology so that we can begin experiencing God within the safety net, the safety mesh, the safety fence
mm-hmm.
of Scripture. But the purpose of Scripture is not for a worship of theology. That's
yeah.
wrong. You've gone in the wrong direction if that's where you're at. You need to reverse and turn back and turn away from worshiping the fence and look at the life God wants you to lead
yeah.
within the safety of that fence. You
yeah.
know, just incredible experiences in God.
Yeah.
To be frank, I actually found this book to be a little bit of a letdown. Because of where I'm at, to tell you the truth. But there were still some really good things. And I mean, his first thing that he said, and I'm only like 12 pages into it. So, I mean, you know, what a horrible thing to say, 12 pages into a book, where he talks about his conversion. He says that it was the result of just staring at a dry and leafless tree, and it stirred up the idea of what the coming spring would bring. And from that point, he began to think about God.
Mm.
I mean, obviously God was using it to reach him and
yeah.
was using it to do something amazing in this brother's life. And so he started by thinking about, I guess, the shortness of life and the reality of change all at the same time.
Mm.
And I've had that experience in small ways before. But I became fixed on something, and it seemed like I could stare at it for hours and hours and hours. Something as simple as that, like a tree or something like that. And it just seemed that your mind opens wide where you're ready to be impressed upon.
Mm.
And God does that. He stops you in the tracks of your life and it doesn't allow you just to commit to only this life, but wants you to commit to him. He wants more for you.
Yeah.
He's not looking for your life to be religious.
Mm-hmm.
When God put Adam and Eve on this earth, he never, ever once introduced them to any form
yeah.
of religious servitude. Not once.
Mm-hmm.
They had a role to do. They had each other and they had him. And it was meant to be a joyful, beautiful paradise.
Mm-hmm.
And we look at religion like, well, that's what God wanted. No, that was part of the fall, part of restoration, part of returning us
mm-hmm.
to wholeness.
Yeah, amen.
Where our point is not religious servitude, but enjoyment with God.
Yeah.
Where we do something in life that brings us joy.
Yeah.
And where Jesus promises that our joy will be made full.
Yeah, amen.
Not our religious servitude and our
yeah.
our somehow pride because we're more religious than the next person. No. Mm. But the idea that we're going to have a joyful life in Him.
Yeah.
You know? So yeah, that anything impress you in that first little tiny bit? We're about to go to what's called, in my book, it's called First Conversation. So this is the, whatever it's called in your book, what's it called in yours?
It is the same thing.
Yeah. So this is the first conversation that this gentleman had with this man who was some sort of a monk. I think Brother Lawrence was some sort of a monk who found a depth in God. And for me, I really started to hit home in prayer. So he's saying, when there's dry times in prayer, by which God tries our love to Him. Well, it does say that God does work things out in us and tries us and proves us. That then was the time. So when things got dry in your prayer time, this man says, then was the time for us to make good and effectual acts of resignation. Now, that sounds pretty deep English. What it really means is to start chopping things off of your life that were no good.
Mm-hmm.
So he looked at dry times in prayer.
Yeah.
It's funny, when we did, what's her name?
Guyon.
She had sort of a different take on it.
Yeah.
But not too different. He basically says, if you're having dry times in prayer, look at it.
Mm.
As God's sort of stopping and you're sort of saying, yes, Lord, what is it? And he's making your times of prayer go inward. And he's showing you that, listen, it's time to cut off this, this, and this, even if it's not bad.
Yeah.
It might just be about time.
Yeah.
But whatever it's about, he's saying oftentimes the moment you will listen in dry times and cut off or obey God and saying, like, don't do this and let these different things go that are taking up your time and just whatever it is, whatever act of obedience it might be, I don't want to even try to make believe what it might be, because it's just that. It's just obedience, isn't it? He says that next step after you do that will very much promote your spiritual advancement. So anytime there's a dry time, it's only time to reflect so that you can jump ahead to that next awesome step in God. And so, yeah, that I thought that was really good. I don't know. Did you see anything?
Well, I don't know which page this is for.
Go ahead,
you.
Yeah.
He talks about being constantly aware of God's presence, you know. He says, to think that we must abandon conversation with God in order to deal with the world is erroneous. So it's almost like you constantly are in communion with God.
Mm.
He probably does set apart time, but after, like, a lot of times we have our devotions in the morning and then we just go about our day doing whatever, but constantly the whole day was prayer.
Yes.
Just, and prayer is not like praying, but just a communication with God.
Okay. Oh, yes. He says, yes. Yeah. I remember hearing Dr. Cho years ago saying, he started by spending lots and lots of time in prayer every day. This man by the name of Dr. Cho in South Korea, he had like the largest church in the world.
Mm-hmm.
He had over 1 million people in it. He spent hours and hours and hours in prayer. He said until he just found himself constantly talking to God.
Yeah.
You know, it just never stopped, never started, never stopped.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an awesome place to be in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but yeah.
To almost allow God into your thoughts.
Mm.
For me personally, I find sometimes, you know, you're thinking about God.
Mm.
I mean, that's good.
Mm.
It's good. But what's better is sometimes I find myself thinking about God, you know, how wonderful he is. And then I feel like him saying, you can talk to me, you know.
Right.
It's almost like, I'm right here, you know, instead of thinking or instead of spending time meditating, just communicate. It's very simple. I like his whole idea of the simplicity of communing with God.
Yeah.
And the way it's explained, all he does is a loving look, you know?
Yeah.
It's just a loving thought. It's that simple. And he says, and God fills them with his presence so much that he can't even contain it.
Yeah.
You know, he has to run and jump around. And
And
I don't think that's true just for him.
No, no.
I think that could be for anyone who has a simple heart.
Yeah.
A heart that's not distracted by busyness.
Yeah.
Or schedules and impressing and striving and all that. I think a simple heart, you know, it's just open. it's like a child.
Yeah.
You know, you can come to God closer.
Yeah, very true. And I find myself too, when I'm driving, sometimes I have a long drive to work in the morning, and sometimes just that, an idea. Yeah. And I suppose it's more than that. I guess it's a revelation, but whatever.
Yeah.
Comes to mind, and it will fill my heart and head with joy.
Yeah.
It will. Yeah. Till I almost have to just, in an excited way, thank God for it.
Yeah.
Thank God for what I just heard he is like, or what I just heard he does.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So I know what that's like.
Yeah. I was talking to my dad yesterday. Mm-hmm. And he said, these days especially, he said, when he's doing dishes or whatever, he said, the joy of the Lord, just, he thinks about Jesus. And the moment he thinks about him, he said, he just is filled and starts talking in tongues.
Amen.
And he said, and he can't explain it to somebody else.
No.
He said, I just can't even tell. It's like, oh yeah, the Lord spoke to me. And so I was like, what did he say? I don't know what he said.
No, that's right.
You know, you can't explain it.
No, that's right. And remember when we studied that last book? No, I'm telling you who it was. It was Bill Johnson who recently said, God speaks and downloads things into your spirit that you only are able to translate sometimes weeks and months later.
Yeah.
It's downloaded.
Yes.
And you're unaware of what it is the moment it comes into your heart.
Yeah. Yeah.
However, whether it be through excitement or like
Alem's
dad had an experience where he was just speaking in tongues, another language of the Holy Spirit, not knowing what that was.
Yeah.
But a week later, he might get the translation.
Yeah, exactly.
Might get the fulfillment.
Yeah.
So, and you know what he said? Bill Johnson said a great thing. He said, the presence of God is the word of God.
Yeah.
The presence of God is the word of God you're not yet able to translate.
Yeah, that's right.
And it becomes translatable as later on in your in the week or later on in the month, boom, it all just comes to you.
Yeah.
And you know that excitement has been there since the moment you felt God's presence, but something finally comes up through the ground almost like a tree or like a seedling has made its way up.
Yeah.
And now that presence of God has turned into a revelation or a word or God asking you to do something, whatever it might be. Something really good, because we are focused so much on our politicians and on our troubles these days. I like this that he said on page 6. But knowing that God could remedy the mischiefs, and that's the mischiefs that people do who are in power, or who are bad, and there's lots of bad people around.
Yeah.
Knowing he used to be really concerned about every bad thing and every bad person and all that they were doing until he got a revelation. But knowing that God could remedy the mischiefs that they did whenever he pleased, he gave himself no further trouble. So Brother Lawrence is saying he just stopped making his life about the stupid things that were and evil things even that were happening around him, because they were easily touched by God, easily changed by God. He didn't focus on them anymore, you know?
Yeah.
He said he had trouble mentally, or in his mind, not mentally, but trouble in his mind that lasted for 4 years. It sounded like it sounded really morbid. I won't read you all of it on page 7, but basically he just came to, how would you put it, sort of like a self-piteous stage where he decided that whether even no matter what was going to happen in his life, good or bad or whatever, he was going to somehow stay devoted to God in it all, you know?
Yeah.
No matter if God was going to show himself to him. He said, this trouble of mine had lasted 4 years, during which time he had suffered much. But you got to remember, these guys weren't living in the revelation of the Word of God.
Yeah.
Like we have now. Fabulous teachers.
Yeah.
You can watch online. I mean, they weren't living in that.
Yeah.
They were by themselves devoted to God.
Yeah.
That's a hard thing to be.
Yeah.
Okay? But that at last he had seen that his trouble arose from want of faith, it said.
Yeah.
He didn't have that encouragement to faith. So everything was a devotion of works to God.
Yes.
Until he found out, he found faith in God. Okay, listen to this. And that since then he has passed his life in perfect liberty and continual joy.
Mm.
Okay? Because God delivered him from that path of works to faith.
Amen.
He just took him from basically death into life.
Yeah.
And when you found out that God could be appreciated just by believing in him and accepting his son, you could enjoy God. So anyway, that I found to be a really awesome statement.
That was
statement.
Probably key in his life, key moment in his life.
That in order to form a habit of conversing with God continually and referring all we do to him, we must at first, this is good, apply to God with some diligence. So this is like you starting out in your walk with God. You're a disciple. You're disciplined about your prayer time and all that. But that after a little care, we should find his love inwardly, exciting us to it without any difficulty. And there are times when that happens.
Yeah, it's like a drawing.
It's like a drawing. Look, it's. I wish it was common in my life. Honestly, I wish I could say, if anything, I wish I could say this was the most common thing in my life. It's not, but I've had times when it has been. And it is a strange feeling to be drawn by God. You can literally feel it from your belly. You can feel it from your spirit. I told Dad one night, I was lying in bed and I was literally being pulled like a magnet out of my bed to talk with God. I don't want my devotion to my devotions.
Yeah, that's right.
I want this.
Yeah.
Him so alive within my spirit.
Yeah.
And that enjoyment, you know, of spirit to spirit talk is exciting. And it's not about how devoted you are or how many devotions you do or whatever.
Yeah.
It's about an excitement that exists between you and God in that open love and conversation that you guys.
I think the only thing that might come in the way is like when Jesus was talking about the cares of this world.
Yeah.
The
worries
of the world.
Yes.
All good stuff, good things. Yeah. But they do get in the way.
For sure.
When he's aware of mistakes in his life, he says he doesn't try to make an excuse. He just lets God deal with it. You know, he doesn't beg God to forgive him. He's like, Lord, forgive me. And he just moves on because it's not like he's surprised by his own mistakes. He's like, I'm only capable of doing wrong, except if God helps me.
Yeah.
So he completely relies on God for his righteousness.
Yeah.
And when he does make mistakes, he doesn't dwell on it.
He doesn't dwell.
He just moves on.
Yeah.
And confesses and lets it go. And then
yeah.
I like that because a lot of us we dwell in something that. Bothers us.
We dwell on our mistakes.
On our mistakes, you know?
I mean, if you're upset by your imperfections, let's be real. I mean, to be totally honest, nobody's perfect.
No.
And I mean, it's good to want to be holy, but to be obsessed with perfection, it will destroy your mind.
Yeah.
And it will destroy your walk with the Lord. It just will.
Yeah.
Because so much of that perfectionism is really egocentric. It's just being attached to your own ego, attached to wanting to look good in front of people.
And when you are good, then you want to pat yourself on the back.
Oh yeah.
And that's terrible. Because on that day, you still fail in front of God.
Yeah.
But you don't think that. You think that, I was great,
Yeah.
So that's a lie.
That's right. You become all of a sudden the judge.
Yeah.
And instead of, a good day or a bad day, what does either mean?
Exactly.
What does either mean when you're saved on a good day and you're saved on a bad day?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, so you're right. You're exactly right. That he was more united. This is the guy talking with Brother Lawrence. That he was more united to God in his outward employments than when he left them for devotion in retirement. Mm. And that's true. That's scriptural. It says obedience is better than sacrifice. It's more important than sacrifice. So when God asks you to do something and you're doing it, look, it's pleasing to him.
Yeah.
It is, you know, and I this is just kind of a shout out to the guys who are working hard every day. And just to let you know, when you're doing that and you're doing that out of obedience to him and you're taking care of your family, you're taking care of your wife and your kids. Look, that means something.
Yeah.
That's a devotion to God just as much as prayer.
Mm-hmm.
It is. It's spiritual. Don't think that you working hard or working with your hands, pardon me, an unspiritual thing to do. It's not.
Yeah.
It's a spiritual thing to do because it's part of honoring God and taking care of your family is part of honoring God. And so what you're doing is in obedience to what God wants you to do. And it's better than just making, like we just said, obedience is better than sacrifice, you know? Okay, guys, so we won't take this make it too long. We're going to start out on fourth conversation. So hopefully this was just a lighthearted encouragement to enjoy a spiritual walk with Christ. And that's been part of our inheritance as believers. For Lem and I, we've been able to have times where we've really enjoyed a deeply spiritual thing with God, and we want you guys to enjoy it too. You're not weird when you have that as a desire or goal in your life or in your heart, and God's all for it. Taste and see that the Lord is good.
Amen.
He wants your senses to be able to appreciate him right here, right now, in the land of the living, right here in this world. He wants you to enjoy and appreciate him. So you guys, you have a great week. And join us again next week. You know what we're going to do? Lem and I thought, you know, we are getting some out of this book, but probably not as much as we thought. And so what we're going to do is we're just going to, it's so short that we're just going to pick out some key things next week, and that'll be it. It's so small. It's just so small of a book. We'll just finish this up next week. And so hopefully you guys will have some time to read it. If you'd like to be able to send any comments to the to either Lem's Facebook page or whatever Facebook page it is, or the Here Now Together, hnt@gmail.com. So anyway, you guys have a great week, and we hope you're enjoying the Lord every single day. And God bless you.